Hello and welcome to unboxing Umbraco 814. We've got a new release out today, and to help me look at this release, I've invited a couple of my dear colleagues. Warren Buckley is with me directly from the UK. Hey, Warren.
Hello.
And we've got Niels Lyngse as well, straight out of Umbraco HQ.
Hello. Hi, Niels.
Hey there. And Warren, you're here as always, unboxing the new releases. And Niels, you've been invited specifically because there's a lot of new UI changes to go over in this release. Some very, very exciting stuff I think we're bringing to the table with this one. And in order to keep this at a reasonable time limit, I think we'll actually jump straight into the big shiny new feature. I think we can safely say, which is the new media picker. You promised to take us by the hand and show us what has actually changed and been updated, Niels.
Yeah, exactly. I'm very, very happy to be invited. And I'm very happy to show this as well. I think it's a feature that we need a lot in the Umbraco. And it actually originates, I will say, mostly from a lot of requests on being able to have local crops.
Mm.
Yeah. So yeah.
I know we've talked about this for years and years for sure. Being able to crop on a specific content item and not for the entire solution, right, is is a feature that is actually quite handy, I would say. So it's great to see that this is in the release. But it's not just that. There's a lot more to the new media picker, right?
When we started having focus on it, we realized we have a lot of other things we want to do. And we even have more we want to do, but we also
there's always more to do.
To get things out there, right? So yeah. I'm really looking forward to show this. And let's just jump straight into it. So here is the latest version, I guess you can call it that, 8.14. Here's an example with a page where I want to where I have the new media picker. And at first glance, you can see it's looks very much like the one you know, but the space thumbnails is slightly bigger. And when you click to add an image, it's the same image picker as you know already. Let's get this thing away. And let's pick this nice image with the croissants.
I'm getting hungry.
And it looks quite a bit like the existing one, but there's some actions here that's changed. You also notice the copy feature. We can get to that later.
Yeah, it's actually quite similar or the same as with the blocking status, right? The actions that have been added there, copy, remove, and I think there's also property actions for the entire property, right?
Yeah, exactly. You can empty out the full property. So that's not such a relevant action when you only have one. But if you had 10 images picked, it's nice to be able to go and remove it.
Yeah.
And the same for the copy feature, that you can copy all the hero images.
Yeah, so if you have references to 10 media items and want to use the exact same in another place, you can actually really easily do that.
Exactly.
That's super handy.
I really hope that becomes handy for some. So one main difference is that when you actually go to edit the media item picked, you will get an overlay previewing that media item. Will not go to the media library, but you will instead view the item that you picked.
Yeah.
And here, if we have local crops enabled, you are able to set your focal point, just like we know from the image cropper today.
Mm-hmm.
To the right side, we have the crops configured for this property itself.
Yeah.
So the local crops are configured for the data type, and thereby they only exist for the media pickers that are using that data type and are not shared by the media items.
Hmm.
But let's try to look at that. So here on on this page, I like to have sort of like an overview of this food. It's not specific about the croissant. I'm just having this cinema look. I might want to adjust that one a little bit, scale it a little bit so it looks good. I have an open graph crop as well. Let me keep it like that. And when I'm happy with that, I'll submit that. And let's try to go to a product page. That's specific for this, the croissant here. So in this example, I'll pick the same picture, just to emphasize the feature.
You could have copied it.
I could have copied it. Yeah, but then I would also have copied the crops.
Yeah,
true. So, yeah. In this scenario, I'm interested in the croissant with the strawberries. So I would like to do some different crops. Let me zoom in here. Let's be a bit extreme, fully close up. The open graph will also be focused on that and submit. And what you will see is that, of course, on our food page, we still have the overview crops here.
Yeah.
Compared with here on the product page, we have a close-up crop, for example.
Yeah.
So that's, I think, the main feature. That's in terms of the local crops, at least. And let's maybe, now that we are live demoing and it's all very rough, let's just jump to the. I don't know what I'm doing here.
I just had one question. So image cropping on media items still works, right?
Yes. Yeah. So you can both have you can have both at the same time, right?
Yeah. So you can actually have global and local crops.
Yes. Depending on, exactly. On what and you do. That that is differentiated in the code when you use the crop in your template. There's a different method for getting local crops.
Yeah.
Fantastic. And if we have a look at the pre-values for the data type, we can scroll down here and we can see that this is how we set up the image crops. So these are the ones for the hero banner that we had on the food page, where we have the cinema crop and the open graph crop, and we can add more crops. Which could be, I'm not that inspired, but we might add this one.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
And it's actually, I really like the way the crops are added there. There's a nice overview of what each crop contains, the label, the alias, all of the things, right? So I think just adding a crop has been vastly improved compared to what was before.
And actually just the detail, like you can have a more meaningful label, and then the alias that you use in code can be a bit more relevant for the developers. And then you even also have the ability to enable the focal point or disable it. Because if we are not using the focal point in our code, it could be confusing for editors that they are able to set it. So in that way, you are now able to enable or disable it.
I think we've seen stray focal points in the back office from time to time where you couldn't really do much with them, but they existed. So really nice to be able to actually remove it, so it doesn't interfere with the editing experience. That's very thoughtful, I would say. Are there any other new additions here? I can see there's something called accepted types, for example.
Yeah, exactly. So in the old media picker, let's see, do I have it? I have it right here. You only had the option to disable folder select or to only pick images. So your options on specifying what types of media you wanted editors to pick were very limited, you can say.
Mm.
So in the new media picker, we can differentiate on the media types. And the 8.14 also comes with new media types, at least if you install it from scratch. If you're upgrading, you need to create these yourself. That means that we ship with a media type called article, which is used for PDFs. We ship with one called audio, which is used for audio files, one for vector graphics, and one for video. And you can use these to define what files you want to accept for your picker.
Mm.
So let's say we only want SVG and the images, then we can do something like this. Yeah, and another great feature is that we can define the amount of picks that we want to go into this property.
Yeah.
So we can be specific that we want to enforce three items, for example, or between one and three items. That's
incredibly handy. Yeah.
So that will help.
When we just now have an SVG picker, so to speak, just by configuring this new media picker, we can have an SVG picker or video picker based off these new media types.
Yeah.
That can be very handy. If you want the content editors to only pick logos that can scale well.
It's really good to enforce. Like certain types of files, documents, or whatever that you then have specific functionality tied to, you can ensure that they're not uploading a PDF, which then breaks everything or something like that, right? So it's incredibly handy, for sure.
And I think a great strength is that you can go ahead and create new media types that fits for your website.
Yeah.
So that could be, if you have 3D models, you'll go ahead and create a 3D model media type that accepts a certain file extensions that fits for the 3D models you support by your website.
Yeah.
So the way it differentiates between the different media types is that if we go here for the audio one, it's made so the file upload field has defined what file types it accepts. So in that way, if you upload a file here in the trying to do something here, I don't know what that is. Oh, it's avoid picking something dangerous, but it's big.
it might be misconfigured.
What do I have? That's not okay. I don't know what I have. But if I upload a sound file, it will be of the type audio.
Yeah, so it automatically picks the right media type if the file extension is allowed.
Exactly.
Yeah, that's super cool. And as you said, you can add your own media types, but you can also add additional extensions. If you have other file formats that you want to add, you can simply do that on the data type that you showed. Or create your own.
If you consider Word documents being a possible article type for your website, you will have those in here. If you have other types that you might consider fine as articles for you can add them here, and straight away the editors can go ahead and upload that.
That's fantastic.
This is a nice usability feature.
Yeah. Way easier than the hoops you had to jump through before with configuration and everything. So yeah, fantastic. So many improvements here.
And what else to say about it? I'm not sure there's
I think that covers it quite a lot. Only thing we might want to mention is back on the media picker itself, there's a couple of shortcuts to the media library.
So if we open up here, we can still go and open this item in the media library.
Exactly. That's really relevant if, for example, you have like metadata on your images that you might need to update, right? It's really great that you can actually access the media item. So,
or if you added additional features. fields that you
want. Yeah, exactly.
That could be for an audio file that you have a cover image, for example, that you want to apply as well.
Or you just need to replace the file and upload a higher res image or something like that.
Yeah, and there's, I think, a main difference here that many content editors have failed in the old one was that they ended up here easily, where they wanted to switch a file for a given context, but ended up switching the file for the media item, meaning that it's changed globally.
Yeah.
That's hopefully very much less a chance now that we have this action right here.
Yeah.
That where you easily can repick, which was not an option before. Before you the only way for you to repick was removing an item and adding
a different one. Yeah.
So being able to do just like this without switching out the file of the media item itself is also quite handy, I think.
Yeah, it's fantastic. Very cool, Niels. Great work. I have to say, it feels really good. I've played around with it quite a lot now, and it is a vast improvement over what we had before. So it's really exciting to see that get out there. And just to note, there is updated documentation for the new media picker available on our right now, complete with racer examples on how you get the local crops out and all of these things, how you use models builder in connection with it, because it of course supports that whether you pick multiple or single items, it'll output the correct type and all of these things. So fantastic feature. Thanks, Niels.
Thank you.
Cool. Next one up.
It's Mr. me. Buckley. It's I'm you. Next. I yeah. go next.
What do you want to show?
I want to show, so in 8.14, we've got improved validation error handling. Mm-hmm. So I will give an example once I log into the back office. So this is a bit more of a bug fix and a usability thing. So if I go to, this is the starter kit that we all know and love, and I create a product and we call this unboxing. I have some required fields here. So if I save it, I will now, rather than get loads of red validation error messages, I'll get these yellow ones.
Yeah.
You could do this previously. You could save the page and get these validation error messages. But what you couldn't do, so say I just fixed, I don't know, just one of them. And we just say this is 10. If I had any other validation error messages present, I couldn't carry on saving the page.
Right, right.
So again, it's just a usability thing in terms of rather than blocking content editors from doing bits of work, maybe they haven't got the full product description from the copy editor, but they could still be setting up the tags and setting up the grid and the block list header here. So yeah, it's a little thing, but it's just these tiny touches that kind of make a big difference.
Yeah, I actually think it's quite a big thing. Running Umbraco trainings in the past, this has been one of the things that I think has been most commented on when we've been working in the back office. First of all, these like red alerts that you get, which can actually seem quite frightening when you save something and then it seems like everything's broken, right? So that's kind of been toned down a little bit now, which is nice.
Yeah, but also, less shouting.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. But also the fact that you actually notified that it's saving the item now, which wasn't really apparent before. It just looked like things were broken. So I think there was added a little check mark, right, Niels?
Yeah, exactly. Now it gives the same response as if there was no validation issues. So the validation issues are there to notify you that you saved with validation issues.
Yeah.
Where before, when you got the red ones and the button turned into a cross, you would actually leave the user with the impression that the save didn't happen.
Exactly.
So hopefully it's a bit more clear now that you actually did save, but you also still know that you actually have these issues that you need to fix later.
Yeah, yeah. There's still work to do.
Yeah, you're not done then.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. No, but it's a fantastic feature. Really nice.
I would stop sharing my screen, but I've forgotten how to do that. Oh, there we go. There is. I don't know what I'm doing.
Excellent. Thanks, Warren. And Niels, you actually have another thing to show.
Oh.
Another couple of things.
Let's see. Yeah. Oh, yeah. So let's, it's still the same example. Sorry for not having a new one. So it's regarding the blog list editor, right?
Yep.
Yeah, good. So previously, if you used the blog list editor when you only had one blog type, you would see the blog catalog, though there would only be one option for you to pick. So that's a bit stupid, of course. So in this example, I've set up the blog list editor as a menu, and the only thing you can add is dishes. So instead of showing the blog catalog when you add something, you just straight adding the blog type that is available.
Yeah.
So in this example, I'm just adding the dish straight away.
Yeah, nice. One less click for me as a content editor to worry about.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
It's a big improvement as well.
So, but what was the challenge with this was also that within or next to the blog catalog, as we call it, the overview of the blog types you have available, you also had the clipboard. So now I just copy the croissant here, but let's copy the strawberry as well. So now we have a shortcut or a direct button to go to the clipboard. It's not visible here. You have to hover for you to see it, but you can say you also have to hover to get to the copy feature. So
yeah.
Actually added a little animation down here when you copy stuff. But let's try to open the clipboard this way, and we are able to paste in the stuff here.
Right, and then you actually get sort of the blog catalog view when you open this up.
Actually, it's still available here because you can still jump from the clipboard to the blog catalog.
Yeah.
But of course, it doesn't have much value in this scenario.
Very nice.
Yeah. That was actually it. I hope
fantastic.
You will be happy for that. I know it's a little thing, but it's a bit annoying if you just have a list of one item. So
definitely, I think there's a lot of editors that are going to be very happy because they're saving a lot of clicks.
Yeah,
exactly. with that change. So really nice. Lots of little great
plus just the little detail. I know it's a wording thing, but before here it said add content because it. Mm-hmm. It would not know what choice you are going to make, right? But now it knows the name of the type you are going to add. So we are able here to let the developer know specifically what it is. So if this was a list of features, it would be add feature instead of just add content.
Yeah, yeah. And so it changes to the actual name when you have only one item configured.
Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah, that's nice. Mm-hmm. Really nice.
Good detail.
It's the details that matter. Or they also matter, at least.
Yeah.
Great. I will share my screen for the final run here. And let's just take a quick gander at the list of issues, features, and changes in the release as well. I'd say, in terms of numbers, it's not the biggest release that we've ever done. I think it's only some like 34 issues and features that have been added, but that's actually nice, I think, to have a small release that's easy to get an overview over. A couple of really notable features, but then there's of course a bunch of small fixes, changes, tweaks, and improvements added by both us at HQ, but certainly also a number of community contributions in there. The accessibility team has been at work again. They're continuously tweaking the back office and making it more accessible. We also, once again, have a number of dependencies updated. So people that use these or like in the packages or whatever, should just be aware that they've been updated. So you might want to check if things, I mean, it shouldn't break anything, but it's a good idea to be aware of it. It's the no UI slider. Examine has been updated as well to 1.2. The color picker and then underscore is also still a part of the back office, apparently, and that's been updated as well. So that's just good to know that these dependencies are updated. And once again, just like we've had for the last, I think, 4 releases, something like that, we actually have a bunch of performance enhancements with the release as well. I think we can safely say that Umbraco is getting a lot snappier than it has been in the past, which is also really nice to see. And a bunch of UI and UX updates, small things, issues that have been fixed in here as well. There was one specific one I was looking for. Let me just see if I can find it. I wanted to call out because, this one from Hare Krishna. He's added the Umbraco logo as a back office icon, which is just great. It makes a lot of sense, right? I saw a discussion about it on the issue tracker, that it's actually useful if you have Umbraco configuration, that you can then use the icon to kind of show that this is Umbraco related, for example. I just think it's so simple, and it's actually kind of weird that it wasn't there before. So really nice little addition. And it's also his first contribution to Umbraco. So he's got a new contributor badge. So kudos, thanks. Really great little tweet there. Yeah, really cool. Aside from that, I don't think there's too many things that are super notable, but a lot of small improvements have been added. I noticed there's added a link to 404 documentation. So if you haven't configured your 404 pages and see the page that has been left intentionally ugly, you'll actually also get a hint on how to fix it now, which I think is quite nice.
That's nice.
Again, one of these tiny small details that really help people make better solutions, I think. So really cool. But all in all, fantastic release. Great new features and a lot of great fixes as well. So the final thing I also mentioned in the blog post is something about trees. Now, we're not talking about the content tree in the back office this time around, but Umbraco has been part of Hacktoberfest, DigitalOcean's Hacktoberfest for the past couple of years. And for this this year, you could get the usual swag that you get if you contribute during Hacktoberfest, or you could choose to plant a tree, which I think is a great option. And the way that we've done it is by using a service that actually plants trees for us, which is quite fantastic. So it's called Ecology, and kudos to Callum White for sharing this site with us. It's a really cool site that lets you plant trees when you need them. So you can basically just go in and buy. And Umbraco now has its own forest with 108 trees planted so far. Of course,
are real trees, not just digital trees. Yes,
they are actual real trees. They don't look that real here, but they are in a forest somewhere. We've got a little plot, which is fantastic. And of course, most of these are Hacktoberfest contributions. There's a ton of potential with this service. They have a whole API layer. But they have a whole API layer. So we could actually set something up that whenever people contribute or the first contribution or something, we could plant a tree for them and do it everything automatically. So there's a ton of potential, and we're looking into how we can start using this. But there's a lot more about this in the blog post where Sebastian talks about how we're using it so far, but also what we are looking at for the future. But I just think it's really cool, and it's so cool to be able to see the carbon offset that we're actually making with these tiny contributions.
Yeah, that's really great.
That's nice to see.
Fantastic. All right. Well, I think that does it for this round of unboxing Umbraco 8.14. Thanks, guys, for pitching in and demoing. Really cool release. And of course, you can get it on the download page. If you're on cloud, it's available through the little upgrade button. And you can get all the shiny new features right there. So thanks, guys. See you in the next one.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye.